let's talk about the People's Initiative, the efforts being done right now. What do you make of these efforts? I mean, you yourself have put in ways to change the charter. You put in constitutional convention, CONAS, Constituent Assembly and People's Initiative. Therefore, attorney, you do agree when you wrote the constitution, when you framed it, that you can change it because you've put in three options to amend it.
Correct. Well, you know, except that we said that at least, you know, not for the first 5 years, but that's over. There are three ways to amend the constitution.
Yeah.
By a 3/4 vote of Congress, voting separately, 3/4 vote, let's call it a constituent assembly, by a constitutional convention, which needs a 2/3 vote of the Congress voting separately. The House has acknowledged that the omission of the Constitutional Commission on putting voting separately in Article 17, Section 1, is to be interpreted as voting separately. In fact, in the rules of the House, Section 145, it says there that proposers to amend or revise constitution shall follow the process of ordinary law. What is that? That is both a separately meeting and separately voting.
Okay, but what do you make of the People's Initiative?
The People's Initiative, it is only for amending the constitution. It's limited to that. Mm-hmm. But the problem is there is no law. There is no law.
Do you still need an enabling law? Some have said you no longer need one.
Well, there is a law. That was passed, I think, in 1989, Republic Act 6735, which talks about amending or revising the constitution, and it did not touch on People's Initiative. Well, there are no provisions on People's Initiative. You read the case of Defensor Santiago in 1977, and the case of Lambino in 2009, right? They both say that all Congress had to do was to enact the law that would include People's Initiative, and they have not done it.
Right? But why won't they be aware of this?
They're aware of it, but it's like...
But why are they then pushing for signatures for a People's Initiative if they're not aware they still need first to enact a law?
Well, you know, I hate to say this.
That's a bit careless.
Well, I hate to say this, but it's a lapse on their part, I guess, no? Because the 19...
But would it be a lapse on more than 100 of them?
They should enact a law. The Supreme Court said, enact the law. They did not. And in the 209 case of Lambino, that was also mentioned. The ponente was Carpio, and in the 1977, the ponente was Lambino.
Yeah. So you have the Supreme Court already saying enact a law first.
Yes.
Effect. And then you can consider the People's Initiative, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so in effect, these efforts are useless. If it goes to the Supreme Court, the Supreme Court will say, look, it's not constitutional for you to go on with the People's Initiative without a law.
Yes, okay. That's unless the Supreme Court is willing to revise the rulings of the court of 1977 and 2009.
Okay.
Now, the second issue... There's another issue, not just there's law, there's no law, is changing the voting jointly under Article 17, Section 1. Is that an amendment or a revision? Because People's Initiative can only be amendment. Now, in the decision of Lambino, it said that when you when you attack a principle of checks and balances that is part of the of a democratic constitution, that is a revision now, and that cannot be done by people's initiative, because the system of checks and balances is not only among the three departments of government, it's also within the legislature.
Yeah,
because there are two institutions in Congress, the Senate and the House. And now if you say voting jointly, you're disempowering the Senate, and the Senate is no longer really a part of the system, because the 24 senators will have only one vote, and the House with but 316 will also have one vote each. So in effect, the Senate does not exist. Total control of the Constituent Assembly by the House. That is not contemplated by the Constitution.
Absolutely. And although I think on that part, I mean, right now there are backdoor negotiations, right? Coming from the lower house to already the Senate for sure, because the lower house, I know that I think it's been passed on third and final reading right now, if I'm correct, but it's already meant to go into the plenary for discussion. It's passed the committee. But before it gets to the Senate, there's already an agreement on the voting. And I believe, and I'm sure you too, that they would first have to agree that if it's that, it's voting separately.
It has to be separately. Otherwise, the Senate will be powerless.
Okay.
It will lose one of its power, important powers of its existence.
Okay, my another question with you is, if the framers of the Constitution, the Commission, actually put in alternatives to amending the 1987 Constitution, why are you fully against changing the Constitution when you yourself put that provision there that one day you can?
Well, first of all, let's clarify what we're objecting to today is the proposal to change Article 17, Section 1 on the Constituent Assembly by adding voting jointly on the call of the Senate President. We're objecting to that. We are not discussing any specific amendment or revision of the Constitution today, right? Mm-hmm. We are not. We are objecting to the process that they want to do to do in order to do it, and that means that the House has total control of the Constituent Assembly, and that is wrong.
But many people will agree with that. I think even the senators won't allow that. So you have that. But other than that, are you against changing any other part of the charter? Let's say they do say we'll only stick to the economic provisions.
As I already said, the thing about the economic provision is just about transactional legislation. Mm-hmm. Different development plan said we are open for business. We have passed the laws ease of doing business. We have passed 11659 on definition of public utilities and public service. You're allowed already in power generation. There can be 100% mining. All right. In other words, in the economic provisions, there is no need for it. It's only there to give an opportunity for more money for corrupt politicians, right? There are some provisions of the Constitution that I think can be improved. Like, for example, the vote for president and vice president should be together. Different parties. And the other one is, of course, a runoff if nobody gets a majority vote. Right? I mean, things like that we can do, yes.
That's interesting. You've actually thought of it. So technically, you are open to changes. And the irony is it's on two political fronts, not necessarily term extension, no, but tandem for president and vice, and an option, a provision for a runoff if yes. nobody gets a majority vote. So we avoid pluralist presidents, so to speak.
Yeah, okay, another way we have to correct the omissions of the Constitutional Commission.
Okay. Yeah,
so on this question of amendment, you add voting separately. Now are two other provisions in the Constitution with the same provision, that with the vote of all the members of Congress, that is on Article 6, Section 28, on tax exemption. And okay. There you can also put voting separately. And mm-hmm. now, but and the other one is the Article 7, Section 19 on granting amnesty. Mm. During the time of Aquino, he wanted to give amnesty to Senator Trillanes, mm. right? And he issued the proclamation, which he had to change mm. because he said the majority of all the members of the House. He had to change that. And that was finally approved by Congress, voting separately. In other words, they accepted that it should really be voting separately.
Voting separately.
So we can clean that up, those three provisions that mentioned by the vote of all the members of Congress by simply adding voting separately.
Okay. All right. This has been quite interesting. So you did think of that, okay, there are some parts of the Constitution that can be improved. That's your word. It can be improved. Yes.
It's
but not the
right?
points that they are mentioning.
Well, you know, it's not perfect because we are imperfect people.
Mm-mm.
No, certainly. And you know, there was a meeting in the Dusit Hotel in 2016 in okay. which we invited experts from around the world on mm-hmm. constitutional law. And their advice to us is, if you already have a system that's functioning, no matter how imperfect it is, just refine it.
Yeah.
But don't revise it, mm-hmm. right? They said. Because, you know, actually, if you look at the world, we have a unitary system. And in the world, there are only 27 systems that are federal and about 160 that are unitary, mm-hmm. right? And all of them have little differences.
Yes.
Right. So we must adjust our constitution to the context of the times. For example, when they tell now about more powers for the president, the context of it is now we are already on a slippery slope to authoritarianism.
Yes. Yes.
Because
we
of the anti-terrorism law, right? Mm-hmm. And then they say. And I think there's a hidden agenda to amend the provisions of Article 6, such as those of Section 25.
Okay, Attorney, you've covered your face.
Let me finish. To remove the budgetary powers of Congress, to remove the limitations on contingent intelligence, confidential, and unprogrammed funds. I think that's part of the agenda. They're not telling us, but that too makes us more authoritarian. Right? Mm.
All right. Okay. Well, this has been a very interesting discussion. Thank you for your points, sir. I do hope that we can discuss this further. Thank you so much, Attorney Christian Monsod, for your time this morning, sir.
You're most welcome. Thank you.